I'd like to thank the foundation for the opportunity to present this work, and I'd like to jump directly to the motivation. As you hear the previous session, and you'll hear at the next sessions during this meeting, microbubbles and acoustic cavitation provides an exciting opportunity and possibility for novel therapies. However, it is clear that in order to achieve safe and effective therapies, you need methods to really fine-tune and guide the procedure. So the motivation of this work is really to develop such techniques that will allow us to optimize the procedures in real time. We do believe that the best way to do that is by using passive acoustic detection technique, and this is because the microbubbles, as they oscillate in the acoustic field, they emit strong radiating pressure waves. And what's important is that these waves, they carry information, and this information can really be used to characterize the type of oscillations. We can tell whether there is stable or inertial cavitation. We can use them to localize the radiating bubbles, and then combine this information to potentially modulate the desired interaction and promote the and fine-tune the exposure parameters. So in particular, passive acoustic imaging techniques and methods have the potential to combine all this information in a single image. So this provides a very compact way to guide the procedures and then optimize the exposure settings. There are already several techniques that are around for passive acoustic mapping. Most notable is the time domain method. That is a broadband method, which means that it doesn't have frequency selectivity, which is essential for characterizing the microbubble oscillation, and it's very slow because the images form on a point-by-point basis. This method has been proposed by University of Oxford. The other method that is using the same method is based on frequency domain methods. It has frequency selectivity, but again, because the images form on a point-by-point basis, it cannot go faster. So we propose the use of angular spectrum method. For those that are more familiar with MRI imaging, this is a K-space method to reconstruct the images. And this technique has provides frequency selectivity, and it's extremely fast because the images are now built on a plane-by-plane basis in three dimensions. So the first thing that we want to ask whether in the two-dimensional limit we can use this technique for passive acoustic mapping, and first we use simulations. So you can see at the top. I don't know where the pointer is. So you can see at the top of the image, you can see that we are able to localize point sources that have been used with using simulated data set. And also at the bottom, you can see that we can do that even when the noise is an order of magnitude higher than the signal. And this is the advantage of a characteristic of constructive interference. So as compared to the two other methods, the angular spectrum method provides the same resolution, the same localization accuracy, and at least equal signal to noise ratio. But it is 10 to 200 times faster from the angular spectrum method and the time domain method. Then we wanted to compare our data, want to validate our data using numerical using experimental data sources, and we used the clinical system from InsideTech that we did, and we incorporated an ultrasound imaging array, and were able to record the acoustic emissions during a typical blood-brain barrier experiment in non-human primates. And again, we were able here. You see the spectrum after the image. And again, we were able to have to localize the point, the location of the microbubble activity, and essentially the target of the treatment. And again, as compared with an angular spectrum method, with a frequency domain method and the passive acoustic and the time domain method, I apologize. So we had, again, the same localization accuracy, the same image quality characteristics, and in some cases, angular spectrum was better. But again, we were 6 and 20-fold times faster. I would like to say these data are using the entire spectrum. This is a frequency selective reconstruction. We can use single frequency if we want. And if we use a single frequency, this reconstruction method is 1,000 times faster than the time domain method that is used by most of labs. So finally, we wanted to see whether the frequency selectivity can be used to characterize the mode of oscillation. You can see here in the rows, you have different reconstructed maps using different frequency components. And in the columns, you see the data from different experiments. And you can see we are able to reconstruct maps with using different frequency components. So what was more interesting, it was when we collected the MRI data, we were able to see that when we had harmonic only components, and you can see there from the white asterisk, we had successful blood-brain barrier disruption and no tissue damage. On the other hand, when we had broadband emissions and point source that showing that we had broadband emissions, we had erythrocyte extravasation and petechia. So it can be used to fine-tune the exposure conditions. So in conclusion, I would like like to say that this method is extremely fast and very sensitive and can be used to guide the procedures in the within the clinical environment. And also I'd like to really emphasize that when we go to three dimensions, these effects and these advantages will be truly augmented, because this is a is a planar projection method. So both all the image quality characteristics and speed will increase even more. So I would like to acknowledge our funding body and Professor Livingstone Margaret Livingstone for her help with the animal work, and Insight Tech for providing the transcranial MR guide focus ultrasound system. Thank you very much.
Any questions? So, are you proposing this to be used for online control during the exposure?
Yeah.
How fast it needs to go?
This can go, can be hardware limited, because this data that I showed to you, the three different images using ultraharmonic, harmonic, and broadband emissions with a standard computer have been reconstructed in half second. So if, and the advantage of this technique is you can split the different frequencies at different processors, and also you can reconstruct different planes at different processors. So essentially you can have all this information in three dimensions in different frequencies in real time.
So can you do a good bone correction also really fast?
That's something that we are working on.